verses 1 to 10. श्री भगवानुवाच अनाश्रितः कर्मफलं कार्यं कर्म करोति यः स संन्यासी च योगी च न निरग्निर्न चाक्रियः यं संन्यासमिति प्राहुः योगं तं विद्धि पांडव न ह्यसंन्यस्तसंकल्पः योगी भवति कश्चन आरुरुक्षोर्मुनेर्योगं कर्मकारणमुच्यते योगारूढस्य तस्यैव शमः कारणमुच्यते यदा हि नेन्द्रियार्थेषु न कर्मस्वनुषज्यते सर्वसंकल्पसंन्यासी योगारूढस्तदोच्यते उद्धरेदात्मनात्मानम् आत्मानमवसादये आत्मैव ह्यात्मनो बन्धुः आत्मैव रिपुरात्मनः बन्धुरात्मात्मनस्तस्य येनात्वैवात्मना जितः अनात्मनस्तु शत्रुत्वे वर्तेतात्मैव शत्रुवत् जितात्मनः प्रशान्तस्य परमात्मा समाहितः शीतोष्णसुखदुःखेषु तथा मानापमानयोः ज्ञानविज्ञानतृप्तात्मा कूटस्थो विजितेन्द्रियः युक्त इत्युच्यते योगी समलोष्ठाश्मकाञ्चनः सुहृन्मित्रायुदासीनः माध्यस्थद्वेष्यबन्धुषु साधुष्वपि च पापेषु समबुद्धिर्विशिष्यते योगी युञ्जीत सततम् आत्मानं रहसि स्थितः एकाकी यत चित्तात्मा निराशीर परिग्रहः नमस्कार मैं हरि ओम टू एवरीवन। अनाश्रितः कर्मफलं कार्यं कर्म करोति यः। He who does is bound in duty, renouncing the fruit of action without depending on the fruit. Sa sannyasi, sa yogi. He is a sannyasi, he is a yogi, na niragnir, not the one without agni, without the fire, na chakriyaha, akriyaha is without action, not the one without action. Simple, straightforward, down to earth definition of who is a spiritual man. Who is a sannyasi, who is a yogi. So a yogi is a spiritual beginner who has relative goals. A sannyasi is an advanced spiritual seeker who has an absolute goal of self-realization. Now it is very important, considering that we are all yogis, we all should be having great clarity as to what is our goal in life. Because we all could go wrong either in having too lofty a goal or too low a goal. So it is important to have the goal so that it continues to inspire, it continues to motivate us, it continues to draw us towards it. So it is important to conceive a relative goal in the spiritual field which will lead you up to self-realization. Because many a time we all would go wrong when we look at the applicability of this knowledge. So the absolute goal is theoretical for most of us. But the practical applicability of that absolute goal is the relative goal. So I want to start the thought with clarifying what is your understanding of a relative goal? Because one of the most important aspects which is not clarified is to have a goal. Many of us seem to be acting without a clear goal or a purpose or a direction. As we all understand, a goal is that which gives us directions. So my question is, what is your understanding? Don't be theoretical here. Try to answer it with your interaction with this knowledge, with your ability to relate to it. You got to give out something which inspires you. So with the knowledge in mind and the absolute goal being self-realization, what is the relative goal that inspires you? So what is your take on a relative goal? Because that's the only thing that's going to take you to the absolute goal. With the relative goal not in mind, with no clarity, it'll be rather demanding to think of the absolute goal. Again, as I've said, please keep in mind it has to be in line with the thought of the knowledge, what the knowledge keeps throwing at you. As we all understand, the Shruti of the Shastras. The Shruti of the Shastras means the Shruti is the backdrop, that constant note, the tune the Shastras maintain is the Atman, the Self. They do not budge. They don't talk of anything other than the Self. That is the Shruti of the Shastras. And we must understand where we are. Okay, so we should also know what is our level and our relative goal. Yes, Tinky Ma.
So, Hari Om Guruji. I think each of us, even though we are on the spiritual path, the relative goals may differ slightly. So, like, if I was to take it for myself, the first thing is I would say knowledge to remove ignorance of the truth of who I am. Understand that. So that is one goal. Then whether through Shruti, reflection, mananan, to understand. Then to purify the mind, you have always said do karma yoga. That is, you do your action with the highest intention for the benefit of the greater good without fruit of action, thinking of that. And focus on the higher. So these become our relative goals on the spiritual path. And the absolute goal for us would be, which it will come, I don't know after how many lifetimes, is self-realization. So at this point of time, like we attend your class, so through Shravana and then understanding and assimilation because of Manan and reflection, first of all is we try to remove the ignorance of who am I? I am the Brahman. Of course, at the moment, they are concepts. We have to internalize that. We have to know it at every moment. Not just believe it, but know it. It has to be like from within, I am the Brahman. And the actual practice, I mean, the actual application would be when I am no longer disturbed by whatever happens around me because I am none of these and the world is also, which is very difficult.
Right.
And then the karma yoga, of course. And for those who are more inclined, a little bit of bhakti is very important because that aspect of devotion and surrender will come through bhakti. So I think a combination of all of these, little varying for each person, would be the relative goals to reach the absolute goal, which is self-realization.
All right. Okay. No, you're not wrong at all. you spelled it out. What is a relative goal that inspires you? Vasanta, ma.
I think the first step would be to, after gaining some knowledge in this field, we should try to use more of our intellect than acting on impulse. Mm-hmm. And because that the mind is very fickle minded, so first we have to calm the mind and have a thorough understanding of what is our goal, how to reach that goal. That urge should be there, that enthusiasm should be there in us. Then probably we will develop more qualities that require for that, like charity. And also from when we realize we are being selfish, we should again think over it and try to go from selfishness to unselfishness.
Okay. So from what you have said, developing one's intellect or engaging one's intellect in as many, if not all, the actions.
Yes.
Right. So the relative goal is that I want to try not to be impulsive. Okay. Yes. And then you also said try to shift from selfish to unselfish. So these are clear-cut relatable goals which you can relate to while you are acting, isn't it? Okay, very true, very good. Yes, Sitaramji.
In my case, what I would like to set for myself as the relative goal is one is to have to do something for others in an altruistic manner. Like with along with Harisha running the school. So I'm saying, so I'd like to do more of those. Plus I have a farm where I have a lot of neighboring farmers who are not, obviously they are poor. I would like to teach them to do farming in a better fashion. So the relative goal that I would like to set for myself is to see that I try and uplift the people who are in my immediate surrounding. So that's one relative goal that I have. If I do that, I I hope I'll be going more towards outside myself. So goals which are not selfish, but more for what they call setting a higher goal. The second would be to understand our Gita better, so that I understand the purpose of all that we are doing and how to proceed further in the path of self-realization with more understanding and knowledge of what is being said by scriptures. These are the two relative goals that I would like to set for myself.
Okay. Very good. Anybody else? Badrinath ji.
Pranam Guruji. For me, it is to be in the now, okay, which is one of the things that I've learned as an important aspect of what we are learning. To be in the now is a mind practice that I need to hone and perfect. The other thing is to question. Now, question my own thoughts and actions, and to question what I learn from others with humility. So the idea of questioning what I learn from others is not from a standpoint of any kind of arrogance or anything, but from the point of view of not accepting anything without processing it in my mind and satisfying myself that that is the truth. It might be a relative truth. At each stage, we are really talking about relative truths, not absolute truth. But I should be satisfied that you know, what I'm learning is the truth from that experience that I already have. It might, you know, with time, it might prove not to be the truth. Okay, so you might go from one truth to another, but at each stage, one's questioning should satisfy oneself that, you know, that this seems to be right and this is the way to go.
All right. I'm not saying anyone of you are right or wrong. I'm just trying to facilitate a process of thinking so that we know that you can, by lending our ears to others, you can know, we know that that very relative goal can have different dimensions to it. You know? It's not just looking at it from one perspective. You know, one could be very low for one, the same thing could be very high for the other. And what is high for you today, you might cross over it and you may have to conceive another goal. You may have to raise the bar. So that's the objective. Kusumaji says, seva with dignity in mind. Sethuramanji says, unselfish service. And you said control over the senses. Could you explain, sir? That's an interesting relative goal.
Yeah. It is, see, I want to withdraw from activities where my energy is dissipated. And also, see, using less of social media and the TV and all that, which diverts, and control over food also. These are some of the, and I want it to be practical and at the same time using my full potential where I go on raising the bars.
Yes, absolutely. In fact, one of the points you said is control over senses means to recognize those activities which are dissipation of energy. That's very, very beautiful point you made. You know, to ensure that I don't do anti-canceling activities. You know, I could be very sincere, but then I could be drawn away into activities which may not be as productive in the attainment of my goal. So a certain clarity, a certain vision, which reinforces your thoughts towards the goal. You know? But that why that happens is because your goal itself is not clear. When the goal is not clear, you get easily distracted with many other activities. And I'm also very happy to hear it from you. I will connect with you in private and clarify this. Maybe you should come to the center. We would have a sitting on this with you. I wanted to bring into your notice and you brought it up. So whenever you're ready for it, we'll have a discussion on it. It's very, very important. So that's very, very good. Control over the senses, avoiding dissipation of energy. Subramaniam Garu, any thoughts?
Well, we have had beautiful points coming up, Guruji. I would just put it the way, you know, we have been using in the management sense. What you have been teaching us, the self-realization is the long-term goal. And when that is a long-term goal, when I know that it is there, but yet not that easy to attain, just as any student wants to become an engineer, doctor, whatever. But then towards that, he needs to take so many steps, baby steps, middle steps and all that. One needs to have short-term goals and then medium-term goals. And then go on assessing that also periodically. Where do I stand? Where have I reached? So like that, if I'm going to go use that, because now I'm at a stage where the achievement parts of far as the worldly things are concerned are all are not a priority at all. It's more slowly moving towards more of you and less of me, as everyone in this class, as you have been so beautifully motivating us all. So when that is the case, what I find very, very satisfying is when I, you know, have 4 or 5 children every day coming to my home at 4:30 to 5, 1 o'clock, 1 hour, all watchmen's children and all that, when I able to share with them something about it through the medium of English, of course, because they're all in Telugu medium schools and all. But then when I'm able to give them some shlokas, some quotations and things, I mean, ask them to discuss and all that using wisdom given by you also. So there I feel that, you know, I'm able to share more. And as I share more, I feel I'm gaining more. Slowly, slowly reaching towards that. Everything else, as Setu said, that's beautiful. Today is Ekadashi. Ekadashi, I'm away. I'm not in Hyderabad. No, I'm in Pondicherry. So I'm not able to have that upavasam the way I would like to, I normally do there. But then because the daughter is there, granddaughter is there. So I just thought that all right, one meal could be that and then nothing else at all. So how do I go about having that upavasam also, which is control of food, control of speech, control of breathing, all these things, how one can do all the indriyas. So trying to do that, Guruji, and then getting some small joys whenever I don't reach these small goals and all that. That's what I would say.
All right. Yes. In general, you're saying about raising your awareness, a greater awareness about the goal and all those actions which take me there. Yes. All right. Okay. Rajima.
Guruji, would it be to be able to introspect at the end of the day or during the course of our action, speech, and our learning, how much we have progressed in our spiritual quotient or our understanding? To be in the company of sattvic people, that's what I... to be able to reflect, like Tinky Ma said, that you know, do manana and do seva, selfless, without any selfless service, without any attachment or expectation of fruit. So if we kind of keep measuring our action, speech, and our learning towards this, then probably we are that's what inspires us.
All right. Okay. Ramji.
Hari Om Guruji.
Yes, sir.
So I feel that the most difficult part of the ultimate goal is nishkam karma. That means you get detached from the results. This is something which we find very difficult to do. So I would like to focus on practicing that while discharging all the duties that I am supposed to do at this stage of life towards family, towards society, towards my profession, but with a higher purpose. But at the same time, practice the art or skill or science of doing it with detachment to the results. I feel that this will take a long time to achieve. So perhaps that would be the thing that I would like to practice.
All right. Appreciate. Very interesting to hear different inputs. Jemma, you had said something earlier. You want to share that, please?
Guruji, I feel that relative goal is first inching towards unselfishness. That is the first step that we should take. And how much we can serve, how much you are the first one to reach to anybody, either the family or the workplace or society. So the whole day you are interacting with people. So how much you are being unselfish in each transaction, that will make your... that will sort of purify you and cleanse you. And then slowly you can, through the studies and manana and things like that and satsang, added advantage you have to really reach the ultimate goal. That is what I feel, Guruji.
Right. Very well. I think a lot of you all have resonated this wanting to be more sacrificial, more unselfish. Very true. All right. Yeah, Sudhakarji wants to say something. Yes, sir, please.
First of all, let us try to understand the full form of the goals. Going on about living. I feel that is a basic important thing what we have to realize. And to live is a human right. And many people are deprived of the basic amenities and basic necessities to live a proper life. And we should be able to concentrate on those areas and try to uplift the society in whatever best manner it is possible with us. That should be our goal. That is what I feel. Goal means G-O-A-L, that is going on about living. Living is a human right. First of all, we have to look into that, you know. We have to protect that. That is what I feel.
All right. Yeah. See, one of the things you all could certainly consider is with reference to this knowledge, the real sadhana is internalization, as somebody said. I can't recall who said it, but the real internalization, digestion, absorption of this knowledge. Because your actions are only reflections of your transformed thoughts. Once the transformation happens within, your responses back into the world are only a reflection of the thought process that happened within. It's like, how much strength I have depends on how healthy I am, how strong are my muscles, how strong is my immune system, how strong is my overall health, that determines how efficient I am, how physically strong and dynamic I am in my life, in my activities. So rather than focusing on changing the performance of the action, you must try and attune to the inner transformation. Once the thought processes change, once you internalize this wisdom, the expression automatically happens, whether be it Ramji said about you must try to be more detached, you know, do perform your duties. And every one of you, all of you have said, whether it be control of the senses or whether you want to be more sacrificial or whether you want to be, nobody said that you could have a relative goal is I want to find myself happy and contented at every experience. I want to be really contented. I don't want to fall a prey to my mind's desires, you know. So all of these are expressions of a established spiritual person. So one of the goals you can seriously have is to capitalize on the early hours of the day, which is 4 a.m. to 6 a.m. The real sadhana, the real transformation happens between that early hours. So one of the goals, serious goals you could have is, I would want to ensure that I inject that discipline into my life so that I am there with the Shastras early morning during that hour so that I am transformed, so that I'm able to internalize this knowledge. And that results in enhancement of sattva. So one of the goals you could have is I want to reach a very high level of sattva, which is all the qualities you are saying. Now, how do you reach that level of sattva is by internalizing, by doing manana, not by merely attending satsangs, by doing manana, reflection, the early hours of the morning, which means you'll have to address your rajas and tamas cycle as well in the day. What time you sleep, what time you get up, what time you do activities, everything has to be. So to streamline your day, your life, your priorities. So your priority should be that I would want to be available for that 1 hour, 1.5 hours in the morning. That could be a relative goal. If that is set and you're clear, and once that becomes a part of your lifestyle, it will start reflecting in the transformation that happens within. Then you'll become more conscious, there's greater awareness. Then you'll become far more objective to your actions. You are very detached. You'll be very sacrificial. All other qualities will start surfacing. You'll be very happy. You'll be very contented. Because these are all reflecting because of from the inner self. So create a rostrum or a schedule where you will abide by it, almost like a military discipline. I will not budge. Whatever come and said and done, I will make myself available for that early morning pratasmarami, early morning studies and reflection. You should do that. Once you do that, everything else will fall in its place. That is a real sadhana. I would say that's a real test. That's acid test. So a yogi has relative goals. And once you reach that, then you can always intensify that sadhana, which is to disinterested in many things that happen out in the world. You're not available. So that ensures unnecessary dissipation of energy. Okay. So a sannyasi or a yogi is not the one without fire, not the one without action. Without action means a fellow who is not tamasic fellow, a person who has the fire means who has that urge to serve a cause. Opposite of that, we learned, is a person who operates on the insatiable desires and running behind the likes and dislikes of the mind. I've already said that, okay? So the toughest thing is to renounce the fruit of action. Hariji, what was the example we gave last week? You remember? Renouncing the fruit of action. You recall?
I'm sorry, Guruji, I can't recall the exact example.
William Shakespeare?
Oh.
Mark Antony. Mischief thou art of foot, take thou what cause thou wilt. Remember that phrase? Mark Antony did his duty to bring justice to the great Caesar, who was assassin. And then he said, you guys do what you feel is right. You know, he renounced the outcome. The same thing Lord Krishna said in the 18th chapter, 63rd verse, he said, yatha ichasi tatha kuru. Having done his duty of giving the knowledge out to Arjuna, he said, now you decide what you think is right to do. Completely disinterested in the fruits or outcome of the action. So detached. I know we spend considerable time. I think we've done justice to the message. All right. So we'll move on. We'll take up the second verse.
यम संन्यासमिति प्राहुः योगं तं विद्धि पांडव नह्य संन्यस्त संकल्पः योगी भवति कश्चन यम संन्यासमिति प्राहुः योगं तं विद्धि पांडव नह्य संन्यस्त संकल्पः Yogi bhavati kashchana.
O Pandava, O Arjuna, O Partha, know yoga to be that which they call as sannyasa. No one verily becomes a yogi without renouncing sankalpa. What is the first half of the sentence? Convey, Harishji. No yoga to be that which they call as sannyasa. What does it mean by that? Okay, let's ask Shivaji. And the English translation, Anna sir, what does the English translation convey? No yoga to be that which they call as sannyasa.
Be detached.
Adingappa. Sir, anga detachment enga vandirthu sir anga?
Who does his worthy duty unattached? Oh, that is the...
Sir, na sentence padikaran, thirupi. No yoga to be that which they call as sannyasa. Means what?
Sannyasi is one who is in the spiritual, firmly in this advanced spiritual path. That who is doing without the attachment.
Okay. All right. No problem. Okay. Harishji?
No, he is just explaining that yoga is what is commonly called sannyasa, or a level of detachment, a level of renunciation. You know, that is what you associate with sannyasa, that you have evolve to a stage where the lesser things don't matter. So he says that is what is yoga. So that state is what is called yoga. Please know that reaching a state of sannyasa is what is yoga.
In fact, the hidden meaning in that, you're all not wrong. It says, know yoga to be that which they call sannyasa. In the sense, he's saying, yoga leads you to sannyasa. A yogi no sooner will become a sannyasi. So yogi is one who is in the initial stages of his spiritual sadhana. Sannyasi is an advanced spiritual seeker. They call prahuhu, they refers to the, who is they calling? See, every word matters, has a message. They, which they call, who are they?
The wise ones.
So Lord Krishna is saying, it is not my thinking, my dear Arjuna. This is how it has been said by the great men, referring to their gurus, which is the concept of agama, which is tradition, where the guru shishya parampara, where the guru never arrogates or attributes knowledge to himself. He attributes to the gurus of yore, to the past, to their gurus. So they have said, so it's almost saying it is a universal truth. So it, don't think it's my thinking of it, that yoga and sannyasa are one and the same. So first half of this line is saying that yoga leads you to sannyasa. So one who is established in yoga will certainly become a sannyasi. It'll all become very clear as we keep moving into the text. And the second half of the verse, he says, no one verily becomes a yogi. Then he says, who becomes a yogi? A yogi is one who is without sankalpa. Who, you cannot become a yogi without renouncing sankalpa. Sankalpa is a milder form of desire. Okay. Wonderful, Ravindaji. Thanks for holding on to the verse. Sankalpa is a milder form of desire. Sankalpa leads to a kamaha. Kamaha is a very strong desire. Sankalpa is a mere passing thought. And you would not become a yogi if you have these thoughts throbbing in you. If your mind entertains these thoughts and desires, which leads you to obsession and a vega, and a thought flow, which is a lava, like a lava of thoughts towards the world. Ushama, so when you have these thoughts, sankalpa, transforming themselves into desire, which flow towards the world, what would you be?
You would be a normal human being.
So a yogi is an abnormal human being, solringla?
Advanced human being.
No. You are all normal. You should be normal people. There's nothing abnormal about it, please. What is this? What do you call a person who entertains thoughts of the world? A yogi, his thoughts are not there. His thoughts don't go towards the world. And that's the definition. Yeah. You don't become a yogi without renouncing sankalpa. But a person who has this constant sankalpa of the world, what is he? What do you call him? All right. No, you have said... He's a
worldly person.
Worldly person. All right. What is the technical word for that? Annapurnama. What is the technical word for a person? Samsari. Okay.
Yeah, a person who is not
not having any inclination towards the higher samsari, who is engulfed in Maya.
Who's engulfed in Maya? Samsari. What is the opposite of yogi? Okay, let's ask Jyotsnama wants to say something.
Guruji, I still had a doubt on the sankalpa. Normally they say sankalpa is to will something. Generally we have, when we do puja and all, they say you have to take a sankalpa. That is like you have to will for something, or you have to desire for an event to do go well or to reach a goal or something. So I just was a little confused about sankalpa as thought or sankalpa as a will. So is there some, you know, very subtle line that I'm missing?
I'm glad I asked you. Something told me that I should clarify what you were saying. See, it is the language of the Shastras. See, whenever the Shastras use the word Sankalpa or Kamaha, they are talking always on a negative note. It's always negative. The earlier verse we spoke about Agnihi, you know, Niragnir. So when they talk of a higher element, a greater cause or a larger purpose, an unselfish element, then it is on a positive note. So the desire, sankalpa, wishing, willing, wanting something to happen, it is all considered selfish and self-centered. If you say, no, I don't have anything for myself, but for the larger good, even that you must drop. Selfish, then unselfish, and then comes selfless. So the Shastras are trying to inspire and raise our bar to perform action without any thought or sankalpa. Then how can you do an action without sankalpa or a thought? Do your karyam karma. Karyam karma is, what is your duty? What is your obligation? As a mother, you have an obligation. Renounce the sankalpa and do your duty, ma. As a teacher, now I have a certain duty. Do my duty without renouncing sankalpa. Karyam karma. As a sportsman, do play your sport, renouncing the fruit of action, karyam karma. So the capacity to do constantly without that wishing or willing or wanting or desiring or the sankalpa is what is the right action. And the moment you get to that, you are a yogi. And the opposite of that is where there is this desiring, wishing, wanting, craving, the obsession of the world, for the world, consumed by the world, then you become a bhogi, as a couple of them have put it correctly. So in the group, Gayatri Ma and Rajima put it that it is a bhogi is said to be a one who is indulging in the world. So remember, indulgence is not at the physical level, indulgence is at the mental level. So mentally, if you are indulging, wanting the world, wanting to possess and enjoy the world and relishing the world, you are a bhogi. You may be away from the world. Physically, you are away. But if you are mentally indulging, you are not a yogi. You are already disqualified. So look at the yardsticks that they are throwing at us. Look at the yardsticks required even to even qualify to begin your journey. You can't entertain the thought of the world. The moment you have the thought, you're disqualified. Out you go. You're a bhogi. Now, if this be so, what is the percentage of spiritual practitioners out there who have no thought of the world, but they have put on a garb and physically abstaining and giving themselves a license to mentally indulge. What would you call such people? I'm not sitting in judgment of anyone here. In fact, in the third chapter of the text, he says this. One who puts on a garb of spirituality, but mentally gives himself the license to indulge in the world. Such people are known as Mithyachara, correct. Mithyachara sauchate. They are called hypocrites. So we should not fall into the trap of becoming a hypocrite. In the name of spirituality, in the name of prayer, what people do? In fact, I always detested, and I'm never comfortable doing it. When people go to a temple for darshan, what do they do? Often do? Instill fear. Enna ma? When people go to temple, enna pandranga, Rajima? Adhu vera question. Okay. Now when idu solungo, idhukku answer solungo. When people go to temple, what is it that people usually do?
They beg.
Begga, ayyo. Enna ma? Why are you so hard at people? I think the best person who would know me is Vijaya ma. Okay, Vijaya.
Close eyes and pray.
Okay. I thought she understood me. She also not understood me.
Archana also, you don't like.
Correct. What is it I am not comfortable with? What is it they do? Archana. And what is Archana?
Telling our name and Gotra.
What are you doing there? You are asking God to bless you only and not others? Why do you have to announce it to the Lord? Why are you announcing your preferential? Why are you announcing your ego? Why are you announcing your individuality in front of the Lord? The whole symbolic representation of visiting a temple is you leave your footwear outside the temple, don't we? The footwear symbolizes the individuality, the real individual, which is the manas and the buddhi. The ego is left behind and you have come to merge one with God. The darshan of the Lord symbolizing you have become one with the Lord. And you go and ask and you announce your name, your gotram and nakshatram, and you say, bless me and my family. Enna apacharam pandranga neenga, apacharam adu, you're doing a cardinal sin, right? In the sanctum sanctorum you're doing it. Whenever these pujaris ask, I say, I do not know my nakshatram. They'll ask your name. I do not know my name also, I say. Strangely, look at me and cuckoo this fellow and they'll go away. You know, plenty of other customers are there. So leave this fellow. So there is no wanting. The thought must go. The sankalpa, the thought for wanting must go. So this is the prerequisite to become a yogi. That desiring, that wanting, that planning, that thought, that indiscriminate scheming or planning. Now, when is it that sankalpa manifests? He is only saying you should not have the sankalpa. But my question is, when is it that sankalpa manifests? Padmini Ma says, when there's a desire. When the ignorance superimposes the reality, when there is a vasana, we get in contact with the object because of selfishness. It is If it is for good of everyone, that also is not right. Not right, ma. No. You may be wondering what is this? What are the texts saying us? Yeah, as long as you keep moving towards selflessness, that's what it is. As long as there's sankalpa, there is going to be a bondage, there's going to be an attachment, there's going to be consequences. So don't seek shelter of getting bound by a thought just because it's unselfish. Don't just justify it. So when does the sankalpa manifest? Sankalpa manifests when there is a conducive environment. When the environment is conducive, the thought comes into your mind. Correct, Ashwaji? When you have a thought for something, when does the thought for something come up? Only when the
conducive
environment. But let's say the environment is conducive, yet the thought doesn't crop up.
Not happen.
No, okay. Before we move further, can you explain, give an example, conducive environment and thought propping up? For example, Kudungo.
You surrender your sankalpa, then also there's a possibility because you're not attached to it anymore.
Sir, I'm just asking a simple, I'm not asking a surrender, sir. I'm asking a simple question. The question is, when does the sankalpa come? Prop. To which I said, when there's a conducive environment. Okay.
Yeah.
Now, can you give an example of this conducive environment? I'm just trying to see whether you understood it.
No.
Actually, it's straightforward, sir. No issue. Somebody is very qualified answering. Gayatri ma, she's talking about bar and all. I didn't know example. So Gayatri ma will explain to us. Anga nariya experience irukka theriyudhu paravaala. Very strong wisdom irukanga. Solunga sir. Solunga ma. Ma, you have to unmute yourself, please.
Guruji, you said conducive environment is not there. So conducive environment is not there means I thought of a bar where suddenly, you know, I start thinking about satsang, the where I attended, how it is and all. Suddenly thought comes, I cannot be, you know, the thought has come, but still I can't attend a satsang in a bar. That is what suddenly struck me like.
That is
the reason conducive environment is not there, but the thought is there.
Oh, even in satsang, you're thinking of the bar.
You're different.
I never knew. My God, Innama, you're surprising me.
It is reverse. I am in the bar, but still thinking of satsang.
I said that
environment is not conducive. So when I am in a bar or something, the environment is not conducive and I start thinking of satsang, Raji Ma, Jaya Ma, Guruji and all means I cannot meet them. That's how it struck me like a conducive environment is not there, but the thought is nice.
All right, I get exactly what you're saying. Yes, Tinky Ma.
So you wanted an example, I'll come back to that motichur laddu only. So if I'm in a mithai shop or I see the laddu, then the sankalp will come that let me eat it.
Not to give it to Guruji, yeah? Very bad, very bad.
But if I don't see, I'm not in the mithai shop, But I'm still mentally indulging that if there was a Motichur laddu and I ate it, you know, it would taste so good and it would give me so much joy, then that is without the conducive environment, the sankalp is arising. That is then mental indulgence.
Yes, yes, yes. Absolutely right. Yes, you're right. Yes, Ma. Thank you. Yes, Edramanji.
The example I want to give is, see, suddenly I got a lottery. I immediately feel like buying a car which I wanted, a luxury car that crops up. Mm. That's an example I want to give. So something, the desires crop up based on conducive. The environment is conducive for me to purchase something big because I got something, a bounty without,
Okay, right. I get it. Yes. Okay, a lot of people, I never realized so many people will be interested in explaining this. Okay, Badrinathji, you are in queue. Maniam sir, you are in queue, Badrinathji.
Guruji, you started with the answer. When you are in a temple, when you are before God, the environment is there. We know that he is omnipotent, omniscient and all. He will be able to give everything that I want. So then that's where the sankalpa comes by. I don't ask this. I give my name, Gotra and all that, and give me Bulke. So you started with the answer and then went.
In fact, interesting though, in the example you have reminded us now, or what we spoke a little earlier, in an environment where you are amidst divinity,
yes,
you are not having the sankalpa of the Lord. You are having sankalpa of your material wants, your needs and your unfulfilled demands.
Yes.
Which tells how non-spiritual you are.
Yes, 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 yes.
Isn't it?
That's the sankalpa's hold on you.
That's the sankalpa's hold on you. The fact that you are even entertaining your selfish demands in a prayer or in the presence of the Lord, yes, it just tells how much a bhogi one is.
Yes, yes, yes. Isn't it? Absolutely.
But imagine a person who is, going back to the example of a bar, you are in a bar. Okay?
Yes.
And the thought of alcohol doesn't come into your mind.
Correct.
The only proof is, even the environment is conducive, the thought doesn't come. The thought would naturally come in a conducive environment. But if a thought doesn't come, it's because there is no vasana for alcohol.
Yes.
So when do the sankalpa crop? Only when there's a conducive environment. Why does it crop? Because there's a vasana. So I may have a vasana for alcohol. Just example, don't misquote me. I may have a vasana for alcohol, but it may not manifest because I have not come across a conducive environment.
Yes, yes.
So you must have answers to these questions and put yourself to test. When does the sankalpa manifest and why does it manifest?
True.
It manifests when it is a conducive environment. It manifests. Why it manifests? Because there is a hidden vasana. And you will only know the presence of a vasana at the sankalpa level. Before sankalpa level, you will not know whether you have a vasana or not.
Yes.
That's the danger in it. That's the reason I said, let me pick up these two pertinent questions and examine this concept of sankalpa. Because many of us say, oh, I don't have any sankalpa for that. Why? Because you are away from the conducive environment. The moment you go back to the marketplace, suddenly these thoughts crop up from somewhere. Why? The vasana is latent. The vasana is, what is that synonymous philosophical, or how is the best way to understand the vasana in the context? Vasana means, unfulfilled desire. Yeah, nama. No, you're not wrong. How is vasana best understood here? Ma, Gayatri Ma, in the context I'm saying is, I may have a vasana and I will only know the vasana when it expresses as sankalpa. So in that context of the statement alone, the answer lies. Don't think of anything beyond the statement. I repeat, the vasana expresses, the existence of a vasana is known only when it expresses as sankalpa. So in this context, how do you describe a vasana? Badrinathji.
It's an innate tendency in you. So it is natural for it to get expressed. So it is...
Sir, all I'm struggling to say all this while natural is a self, unnatural is vasana. Ninga poi ulta solringa, you're telling ulta.
No, what I'm saying is vasana is something that, that it's not something that is learned. Okay. It is there with you and it expresses, and over a period of time, you get less attached to your vasanas and more to your spiritual journey. But there's something else I wanted to share before that. Can I do that?
Yeah, when you're talking, is it going to take us away from this thought?
No. I'm talking about, I think it's connected. We are talking about conducive atmosphere and vasanas. The real life example I can give is, you take a typical co-education school. Okay. Many of us have studied in that. Up to a certain stage, the boys and girls will avoid each other like plague. They don't even like to be seen with each other. As they grow, at a certain point in time, maybe in high school or something, suddenly some boys and some girls will start getting interested in each other, but not all boys and all girls. So the conducive atmosphere for that kind of thought is there for everybody. But certain people will start entertaining those thoughts, certain others don't, and perhaps it is because of the vasanas they carry. It is not right or wrong, but that is the reality.
It's a natural progression of age and a natural attraction towards the opposite sex. There's nothing unnatural about it. It's just something which happens. And I can relate to the example.
Yeah.
Okay. Right. Yeah. I get what you're saying. Yeah. I suppose everybody gets what you're conveying. But I want to come back to that question. And when you said it is natural, I'm not talking of the natural aspect or the innate nature you said.
Yeah.
So the other term for vasana, Shivaji is saying, is latent. It's not, again, it's innate. When you say latent, means it's there. It's innate. What's the other word, Harishji? What's that?
Sorry, Guruji, but I also said something on the same lines as Shivaji, which was a base level desire or a hidden desire. Because, but then it shows that it is there.
Mm.
So, and
how do you know it's there? See, you only know when it manifests as?
When it manifests as a thought. As a thought, even though the atmosphere is not conducive for it.
No, it may. See, if something manifests even when it's not conducive, that means the vasana or desire is so strong, it will take you to an environment. See, when you are hungry, you don't need food to trigger the thought of food, because the hunger is there. You will go in search for where is a vegetarian restaurant, or where is a restaurant you would want to go for food. There is no restaurant nearby, but the hunger drives you because the desire takes you to an environment. But here the examination is, do know whether I have a vasana in me. So the term for vasana is known as, vasana is also understood as an unmanifest desire. It is, as Gayatri Ma put it lastly, she said, it is unmanifest. You do not know that it is there. Isn't it? It's unmanifest. Now we go back to that statement. What was the statement I made, Rajima?
The vasana expresses as sankalpa.
Vasana expresses as sankalpa. So how do you describe the term vasana in the context? It is unmanifest. So before sankalpa, you do not know whether you had a vasana at all in you. See, I do not know whether you understand the effort being taken or the methodology being adopted is to teach this knowledge to you. I am not giving you a pravachan and walking off. It is very easy for me to cover 5-6 verses in a class, if not more, and then finish the text in a matter of 10 sessions or 4-5 sessions and finish it off. You know, but you will not, it will not convey, you will not learn. Teaching is a different ballgame. You must understand that, and that the only way it is possible is through an interaction. That's the reason I'm questioning you all, is not to unsettle you or to reveal your ignorance. No, it's just to ensure, to make you think along, and so that it sticks with you. Once you go through this process, believe me, you will not forget it, because you have exercised the thinking along with me. So please don't ever, not that you have no faith in the teaching, but just don't compare this to any other satsang you would have, or you were part of a journey, because it's completely different. The approach is entirely different. Yeah? So I think a couple of them had asked something. Ramji is asking, Guruji, is it wrong for someone in trouble to go to a temple and pray seeking relief from the trouble? See, it's important and fundamental that we should understand that God is not preferential. He's never been. His love and grace is universal. And it's not that you are excluded and others are more inclusive. And our prayers are not to be understood as a message that is being sent to the Lord seeking a personal satisfaction or to seek a personal favor. Is prayer a route to satisfy and seek and satisfy your personal appetites or personal challenges or demands, or to provide for your own personal well-being? Is prayer to be understood as that avenue? Sadly, it is being looked at it. So in the contrary, the prayer is a way of expressing our gratitude or thankfulness for whatever has happened in life, because everything happens, whatever happens, happens for the good. And the Lord has no direct role in that happening. The God has no role in all the good that has happened to me or all the challenges I'm going through. God has got nothing to do with it. Why, in the context, you said somebody is in great trouble, he's seeking relief, he's in dire situation, or he's going through difficult times, he should understand it's the law of life that's functioning meticulously. The law of life is the law of causation, the law of karma works. So I have to gracefully accept the consequences of what I have done. And you seek an environment of satsang or prayer so that you're able to entertain positive thoughts so that they become seeds of future actions, and also gives you the strength to accept life gracefully. So you seek the satsang or the Lord only to give you the mental atmosphere so that you can generate positive thoughts and don't not be a victim of the challenges you're going through. But the challenges are not decided by the Lord. Neither will my prayer reach God, because God is not an entity there. God is not, I don't know, someone who is waiting to receive our prayers and is not someone who's sitting there to answer our prayers, and is not someone who's going to fall for your offers. So don't go into a trade deal with God. You can't get into a discussion with God. Okay, God, I'm going to do this. You know, what do you call, I don't get the right word. What do you call that? People do what is known as many? Anna Hariji, I'm lost for words here.
Are you thinking of barter?
Barter is that word, but in the... barter na enna sir adu?
Giving one for in exchange for another. Giving something in exchange for another.
Correct. So
you give gold and get back grain or whatever.
Ama. So on the madri, so you people will say, I have prayed to Lord Balaji, and I'll climb the steps and come to you if this will happen. If my child gets well, I'll come and do offering. I'll not take the vehicle. I'll climb the seven mountains and come to you. So what is that? It is a barter dhan. It's an exchange system.
Quid pro quo.
Huh?
Quid pro quo.
Yeah. These are all disqualifies us for yoga. No sankalpa at all. The qualification of becoming a yogi is you must renounce sankalpa. First thing is stop thinking about yourself. That's the first acid test of a spiritual person. You stop thinking about yourself. And in the name of spirituality, in the name of prayer, you're only doing for yourself. It should hurt you from next time you are in that situation. When these thoughts come to your mind, something should come and alert you and say, no, I wouldn't do this. I shouldn't do this. Because the law of life is fair and even. And God has got nothing to do with it. Let's be very clear. God is understood as a pure objective witness. It enlivens everything. And it has got nothing to do with it. So God is not responsible for what's happening in your life. It doesn't mold you. It can't be accountable for what's happening. It is just an objective witness. It is the truth, the reality, the consciousness. That's all. I seek the thought of the Lord so that I can draw my actions towards it, but not to seek something from it. There should be a difference. Why you entertain the thought of the Lord is so that your actions are oblated towards it, not to seek something from the Lord. The moment you seek, the moment the thought of sankalpa, of wanting something comes into you, remember, it's like a drop of lime in milk. It spoils it all. And it's not my words. These are the words, you know. Nahya sanyasta sankalpa yogi bhavati kashchana. Very, very powerful description. How much we are close to it, it's a subjective self-analysis. Each one of us have to go through analyzing ourselves. Wow, I missed so many of the comments here. See, Jyotsnam is asking, can God be how do you spell that? Confident. Okay. Whereas even if we not. But see, you are either seeking emotional solace. You know, in the fourth chapter of the Gita, Lord Krishna says, Chaturvidha bhajante mam jana sukriti norjana artho jignyasurarthi jnani cha bharatarshabha. There's the four types of devotees who come to me. We have overshot, but just quickly I'll wind up. The four types of devotees. First type of devotee, he says, he comes to seek material benefit. The second type of devotee comes to seek emotional solace from the Lord. The third comes for mere curiosity, jignyasu. And the fourth, he says, he comes to me to seek me. He doesn't come to me to seek something from me. The moment you go to Lord to seek something from him, whether be it material, physical, emotional, intellectual, he says he is not my devotee. But if somebody constantly comes to you only with the intention of trying to abuse your goodness to get something from you, would you consider him as your friend or someone who is an opportunist? He is using that name of friendship only to be self-benefited. The moment his benefit, he's not interested. Like yesterday, I was in conversation, there was an electrician who was here, and he was telling, he was in with partner with a person, he made use of him, and then he used all the, he took away all the profit or all the contract money, and he didn't get his share. In the name of friendship, he abused him, let's say. God is necessary, yes, it's a necessity, but not to abuse God. God is there so that you grow in strength. It gives you that support. Even parents should not be abused, isn't it? Parents today are used, become, what I would say, nappy changers. I would want to go, my daughter-in-law want to go, we both want to go and do our work, so what to do? Parents will come from India, they'll stay there and then only take care of my children. What I do, I will do travel the world, I do my work, this and that. You have taken up, you want a children, be obligated, be responsible. You can't have everything in your life. Just because the attachment of grandparents, you abuse them? Yeah, well, attachment, total abuse going on. Whenever I'm in that situation, I said, I'm not available. I'm not available. That's not me. I have better things to do. I was not available for my daughter only. Forget my grandchildren. So it's not abuse, ma. So please don't get it. Don't abuse it. But use draw the inspiration from the Lord, from the higher, and uplift yourself. Okay. We'll come back. It's a very profound thought. It just needs to sink in. And don't be hard at yourself. It's just giving us the direction so that our thoughts we are given the right guidance, you know. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnamevavashishyate Om Shanti 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 Hari Om Sri Gurubhyo Namaha Hari Om.